you and highlight that we have in our the pews in front of you, our connect cards. These are meant to just be ways to of us reaching out to you, that if you are a visitor and would like to get to know
us a little bit better, to please just leave your contact information on there, and you can put this in the offering plate as it goes by. This is a no-pressure thing. You're not going to be added to tons of mailing lists or anything like that, unless you want to be. But this is not a spam thing, but it's just a way for us to get to know you better and to reach out so we don't have people coming to our church and not feeling like they were welcomed appropriately and connected. And so if you are new to us, please fill this out if you would. If you are not new to us and would like to share a prayer request that is maybe a little bit more confidential than sharing it in church, you can write that on the back of this card and put that in the offering plate as well. So feel free to use these for prayer requests as well. Just write those on the back and we'll make sure we address those appropriately this week. Our mission at Trinity is to love God completely and love God selflessly. And so that is what we are here for. And we are excited that you are with us for church this morning. A couple quick announcements. We have a lot of fun stuff coming up in the life of our church that if you have a bulletin with you, all of them should be on the third page. The first I wanted to highlight, in a couple weeks on March 15th, we are having a chili / soup cook-off. And so I have a couple of clipboards to pass with that, because you all don't sign up for stuff unless we pass it in church. That's what we're doing. There are two sheets on this sign-up. The first that you can see is for if you'd like to make a chili or a soup for the cook-off. Okay, you can write your name and the kind of chili you're going to make. John Geisler said he's going to make one with, like, scorpion peppers in it and stuff like that, so beware of his. The second sheet is if you really don't, if you can't make a soup or a chili or don't want to, but you'd like to help out by bringing some chips or bread or cheese or whatever, you can sign up to help out with that. We want to make this a fun event for our church family, and we need pretty much everybody to help out in some way. So I'm going to pass this back on this side. If you want to make a soup or a chili, sign up. If you can help make or bring something, please sign up. I'll pass this back this way. Thank you, Griff. And so that is coming up again in a couple Sundays. On March 15th, we will have the cook-off after this service. So about 11:45 is when we'll have lunch together. So again, that is the 15th. Another announcement I wanted to make is both a praise and an announcement. A lot of people have been asking about Kate and her baby. And this is Shiloh Marie Arndt, who was born last Sunday, I believe. The baby is doing great. She is healthy. Kate is healthy. The family is happy and doing really, really well from what I understand. But we want to bless them with providing them with meals. And so after service, Pam Poland is going to be in the back of the sanctuary with a sign-up sheet for meals. If you can help out throughout the month of March providing just any kind of meal for them, excuse me. They said they don't have really any dietary restrictions. They'll eat anything. So if you want to help out in that way, please do. Kate's contact information is on that sheet. So what we're asking is if you can make a meal for that day and just contact Kate on an arranged time when you can drop it off. We're really not looking for people to drop in for a visit during those times, because that can be kind of overwhelming when you have a new baby. But for just a quick hi and to drop off a meal, if you could do that, that would be a huge blessing to them. So the sign-up sheet for that will be after service. Pam Pullen will be in the back with a clipboard. You can find her, and if you don't know who she is, ask me, and I will show you where Pam is and who she is. Lastly, small group launch party is next Sunday. So our small groups aren't going to be our main vehicle for discipleship going forward. If you have not had an opportunity to sign up for a small group, or maybe you're already part of one and that's okay, the sign-up sheet for that, this is kind of the last chance sign-ups for small groups. They are on the coffee bar. So if you'd like to sign up for one, please write your family's name, who from your family is going to be attending, and what days of the week work best for you to participate in a small group. If you have a work meeting every Monday night, that night's not going to work for you. So just write what days of the week will work best for you. Justin and I are going to try to put together as best we can those small groups with, like, what nights work best with what leaders and all of that stuff this week. So we're all set for the launch party next Sunday. It starts at 6. We're going to have dinner. We're going to have some fun and trivia stuff, and we're going to really just get to know each other better through our small groups. Anything else that I'm missing from that?
No, just if you're like, small groups, I don't know what that means, you haven't been here very long, that's fine. Join us in a Sunday school class. That's probably an easier on-ramp. But if you've been seeing us talk about small groups, we really want to encourage you. And if even now you're like, I want to, but right now this season is too tough, in June we're going to have another launch.
Right.
So we're gonna develop small groups. I don't want you guys to think, well, I didn't sign up in March, so maybe next March. Like, no, we want this, if this is something that's important to us, not just programmatically, but as a church, so.
Yeah, and for small groups, you're not committing for like a 2 or 3 year commitment. For this one, we're just looking to, we're trying it out for 6 to 8 times, and if it works out for you, continue in it. If it doesn't, we're gonna give a chance to maybe try something different. So if you sign up for a small group, it's not like this is what you are doing every Tuesday night the rest of your life. It is, you know, when can you meet with people? Maybe you're meeting every other week, maybe you're meeting every single week, but we wanted to just do something beyond Sunday morning for us to grow closer to Christ and closer with one another. And so we are really prioritizing this and hoping it takes off huge. Our small group leaders are really excited about it. We have lots of great host homes for all of these groups. And so I think God's been preparing the way for us to do this. And we're really excited about what he's doing. I think that's it. If I missed anything, we also have a midweek email that Karen puts together and does a really great job informing everybody about what's going on in the life of the church. If you do not get those, you can fill out, again, one of these Connect cards. Just put your name and your email and write, add me to the midweek email. So if you do not yet receive those, that's a really good way to stay connected. So please just add your name and your email, and we'll make sure we add you to the midweek update emails. But I think that's it for now. That was a lot. Why don't we pray before we stand and worship together? Lord God, we thank you for the beauty of your nature outside and just to seeing the two seasons collide with the beauty of the sun outside and the snow on the ground. It is awesome to see you at work. And I pray that we are in tune to how you are revealing yourself to us. That this Sunday morning service is not about what we get from you. It is about more about what we give to you. But we also pray that you show up in huge ways. That your spirit is on display. That you are drawing us closer to yourself. That none of the stuff that happened this week is inhibiting us to get to know you more. And blocking us from hearing what you have for us in your word this morning. So I pray that our worship is an offering to you. That it is pleasing to you. I pray that our time together is, again, drawing us closer to you. So use this time, we pray, Lord Jesus. Thank you for it. Thank you for our church family. All this we pray in your Son's name.
Thank you.
Sometimes it's easy because we're in a good place where we've seen you do some incredible things. We talk about the birth of babies. We talk about provision in families and you meeting needs and doing healings. And then there's times where it's hard, as that song said. Like when you won't move what I want you to move, when you're not coming through the way that I want you to come through, I'm still going to trust you. We've all seen you do too many things to not trust you. So we ask today that as we're here together, as we're here not for ourselves, not to make ourselves feel better about my faith in God, we're here to learn, to experience more of who you are, to understand more of who you are. And hopefully this act of worship, this act of obedience of being here this morning is something that plays out in our weeks, that we understand it's not about an hour on a Sunday, but where are you and I throughout this week? It makes those times of trusting a little bit easier when I know who you are better, when I spend time with you regularly. So God, we ask that in this time, as we take offering, it's something that looks weird from the outside, but it's us as a body of believers saying, I support what God is doing, not just at this church, but in this community. But I do trust this church and their leadership with my finances that God has provided me. God, everything we have comes from you to begin with. So we just ask that you would use it as you use our time, as you use our talents, that you would also use our finances to be honored. God, no matter what we're walking through, take what we have and multiply it. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
are here can head down to Children's Church if they would like to. As the kids head down, our scripture reading for this morning comes from Romans chapter 5. And we're going to look at verses 6 through 11. If you'd like to follow in your own Bibles or your own phones or whatever you have, you can. We're going to be reading from the New Living Translation. Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 11 says this. It says, when we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Now, most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who is especially good. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, he will certainly save us from God's condemnation. For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of his Son, while we were still his enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of his Son. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God. Let's pray as we head into the message this morning. Lord God, we thank you for this word of hope. We thank you for all that you have done for us and continue to do. In this moment of exploring your word and worship, I pray that this all of the stress or difficulties or obligations of this week just fade away so we can focus on you. I pray that our hearts are open to where your spirit wants to take us, what things you need to us to be awakened to, what things you need to convict us of, what things that you need to encourage us in. Any of it, Lord, we are open to it. So, Lord, by your spirit, just use this time. And may these words not be at all my words or my perspective. May you use me to represent you well. Lord, we thank you for this time. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Well, I am thankful that you are all here. And since college, when I was at Houghton, I took a class on sociology. And I didn't think I'd like the class. The professor had kind of the reputation of being somewhat of a curmudgeon, but I really fell in love with the study of sociology and the study of people and people groups and things like that. And so, oddly, it's kind of a cool side perk, I guess, of being a pastor is that I get to look out on a congregation of people and kind of see the different faces and different specialties and professions and levels of expertise. That when I think about our church, we have so many different occupations represented and areas of specialty represented. And when I think about it, there are people in our church who are in education, and others are in manufacturing. We have people in banking. We have people in the medical field. We have people who are experts at construction. We have others who are in sales, we have all sorts of different ones that I can't even name all of them, and it's so cool to see us all come together as one, even though we have all these different backgrounds. But what I find really, really interesting is that when we consider all these different specialties, and maybe your specialty is what you're studying in school right now, or what you'd like to study someday, I really like to think about the different sort of even secret lingo that develops within our professions, that in your job, you use terminology that only really you and your coworkers know, and anybody who heard you talking about those things really wouldn't know what you're talking about. For instance, I'm going to use the medical field as an example. Do we have anybody who's former or current doctor or nurse in the medical field here? Because you're not going to know what I'm talking about. So when people in the medical field would understand this, they say, it says, he has a left intratrochanteric fracture, and he's going to need an ORIF. And if you are a nurse or a doctor or a paramedic or somebody like that, you might know what that means. If you're not, you have no idea what that means. And I only know that sentence because my mom is a nurse, and I asked her to give me a sentence, and she gave me a confusing medical sentence. But when I go to annual conference, my profession, I'm a pastor, I'm a UM pastor, which UM is United Methodist, if you didn't know that. When I go to annual conference in Syracuse every June, I'm surrounded by other United Methodist pastors. And it'd be common for me to hear something like, the chair of DECOM wanted confirmation about my stance on UMCOR before she could recommend me to BOOM. OK, Okay, for me, that sentence makes perfect sense. And if you've been a part of United Methodism for a while, maybe you understand some of those acronyms and what we throw around all the time. But people who aren't UM pastors probably think we're nuts in some of the stuff we say. However, this hidden lingo isn't just in our jobs or in what we're studying. We have a lot of parents represented here. And maybe parents, maybe your kids are out of the house, maybe your kids are still in the house, and you have their friends come over, and you sort of eavesdrop a little bit, even though you know you shouldn't, and you hear them talking, and it sounds like they're speaking a different language. If that's you, I have a video that I want to show you that might help you interpret it a little bit better. Check this out.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Carl. So it seems like every other week, the kids of Generation Z seem to come out with new slang terms that quite frankly confuse the rest of us older generations. So the goal today is to learn how to speak some of that Gen Z lingo. And joining me today on how to translate some phrases is our favorite spokesperson for the Gen Z kids, my cousin Brock. Say hello, Brock. Brock, say hello.
Stop.
Alright, let's get started.
You guys have the Wi-Fi password?
Alright, Brock. We're gonna start with some simple ones.
Yeah.
Okay. Hello. How are you?
Saw.
Friends.
Fine.
Family.
Fine, John.
It was a fun event. The fest was lit. Okay.
Over.
I'm about to leave.
I'm finna dip set.
Those are some neat shoes.
Them kicks are dripping.
I would be glad to help.
Bet.
My favorite team lost.
Dudes took an L.
My favorite team lost very bad.
Dudes got clocked.
Who seems upset?
He little knife.
He seems very upset.
He big knife.
I like this music.
That's a bop.
I'm not lying.
No cap.
I'm sorry that happened to you.
Oof.
That's an interesting statement.
Weird flex, but okay.
I'm not a fan of these appetizers.
These apps are beauty.
I completely agree with that statement.
Facts.
I agree.
You do?
Excuse me.
You?
Wow, that's exciting news.
You?
Congratulations on your baby boy.
You?
What does ye even mean?
Ye is ye.
That doesn't help. It's like when the fan comes slipping in with the dripping swag, jammed into some sick bop. And no cap, you know these facts are about to be laid fresh to death. You're like,
oh.
I'm not big enough that big a response.
You?
I don't get it.
Little flex, but okay.
I don't know.
All right. Watching that video is exhausting. Might have to grow out my hair like that to connect with the younger generation. Not going to happen. Anyway, all right. So that video is ridiculous, okay? It's hyperbole. It's blown up to make it way bigger than it really is. Maybe some kids talk like that. I don't know. But the point is that we have these kind of hidden sources of lingo in what we do in our jobs. And sometimes, you know, kids are doing that, whatever. But I think we need to be honest that we do sort of the same thing in church. That we need to acknowledge that in the church we have a Christian lingo that everyone sort of just assumes that everybody else knows. And so you hear it in Sunday school, you read about it in articles, and you hear it in sermons sometimes. And a lot of times we're just kind of pretending that we know what the words mean so we don't seem like we're the spotlight is on us. But a lot of times we don't know what these things mean. And we don't know why they're important. And so over the next few weeks, we're going to unpack a few terms that you have read about in read in books, heard in sermons, whatever, just used as Christian lingo. And they're important things, but a lot of times people get confused about them. And what I want to do is talk about what these things mean and why they're important. Okay, why is it important for us to understand these terms so that it helps inform our relationship to Christ? And so back to our scripture reading. We began by looking at Romans 5, verse 6. And I just want to start at the very front end of this one verse. It says, when we were utterly helpless. Romans 5, 6. When we were utterly helpless. And we're just going to stop there. That in Christian theology, this utter helplessness is sometimes referred to as depravity. And that's going to be our focus for today. And going forward, if you're a note taker or whatever, if you want to take pictures of the screen, that's easier. Then the next slide is sort of our home base understanding of what this word means. That depravity is defined as the innate corruption of human nature due to original sin. The corruption of human nature due to original sin. So what does that mean? It means that something is off. That something is just not right about what humanity was created to be based on what happened in Genesis 2 and 3. Back in the beginning, back at the creation narrative, what happened there with our rebellion, with humanity's rebellion of God, changed things about who we are as humans and how we relate to God. So I want to read a couple of verses from Genesis 2 and 3. So Genesis 2, starting in verse 15. You're probably familiar with the story, but it's important to recap. This is where this whole idea of original sin and depravity began. So Genesis 2, verse 15. It says, "The Lord placed the man in the Garden of Eden to tend and watch over it." Okay, so even from the very beginning, God is using humanity as there's this partnership between humanity and God, that God has a calling for us. He has a purpose for us, even in the very beginning. That God had all the power in the world to tend to the garden himself. He gave that responsibility to humanity. Verse 16, "But the Lord warned him, 'You may freely eat the fruit of any tree in the garden, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat its fruit, you are sure to die.'" Pounce over to Genesis 3, verse 4. "You won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. The serpent contradicted God, but the serpent lied. "God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil." We looked a little bit at this passage last week. Verse 6, the woman was convinced. She saw the tree was beautiful and the fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were open, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. When the cool evening breezes were blowing, the man and his wife heard the Lord God walking about in the garden. So they hid from the Lord God among the trees. Then the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He replied, "I heard you walking in the garden, so I hid. I was afraid because I was naked." "Who told you you were naked?" the Lord God asked. "Have you eaten from the tree whose fruit I commanded you not to eat?" The man replied, "It was the woman you gave me, who gave me the fruit, and I ate it." Then the Lord God asked the woman, "What have you done?" Stop there. So this is humanity's fall into sin. And when that happened, and we read in the story, things like when sin was introduced, things like shame was introduced, and fear, and blame of other people. Things like removal from God's presence and spiritual death came with it. And so in that moment of sin, in that moment of rebellion, humanity's relationship with God was broken, which resulted in our relationships with one another also being broken. That we are still created in God's image. Adam and Eve were still created in God's image. They are still his image bearers. But in that moment of sin being introduced, something changed. The image of God somehow became just distorted and twisted into something different. To grasp the meaning of this word depravity, we really need to understand that the result of sin entering the world is spiritual death and separation from God. This is what resulted in Genesis chapter 3. The result of sin entering the world is spiritual death and separation from God. Okay, and this reality, this understanding of humanity's situation, this isn't just present in the book of Genesis. This is carried throughout the scriptures. In Romans chapter 5, Apostle Paul writes this. He says, "When Adam sinned, sin entered the world. Adam's sin brought death. So death spread to everyone, for everyone sinned." Okay, and we look at this verse and we see the word sin a lot. And so it's important to understand what we mean by sin, because there's two different ways of looking at sin. And sometimes when people say sin, they think of the sins that I have committed. The individual acts of rebellion against God, my words, my thoughts, my behaviors, my actions, my attitudes that go against God's will, and I know it goes against God's will, but I'm following that path anyway because my way is more important. Okay, so there's that understanding of sin. There's another understanding of sin as a state of existence, the state of sinfulness that we are all born into. A state of spiritual death due to sin being introduced into the world. And all of that is what depravity is looking at, what depravity means. It goes back to Romans 5, 6. When we were utterly helpless, born into helplessness, born into a state of spiritual death. And so it's not all the time where I ask for participation in the sermon, but I have a question for you. It's really easy. What can dead people do? This is not hard. Nothing, right? Have you ever seen a dead person do anything? No, they kind of lie there. Okay, dead people can't do anything, and spiritually dead people can't do anything. Spiritually dead people don't even know that they're dead. Spiritually dead people don't recognize their need for God. Dead people cannot make themselves magically alive again. Dead people cannot do that for themselves. And so those who are spiritually dead because they are born into a state of sinfulness and into a broken world cannot make themselves alive again by any means. We can't make ourselves alive again by our morality. That me being a really good neighbor, a loving neighbor, a selfless neighbor, cannot make myself spiritually alive. Going to church, participating in church, joining a small group, becoming a church member, tithing all the time, doing all these things we know we should do, those things cannot make me spiritually alive. Loving my family can't make me spiritually alive. Serving others cannot make me spiritually alive. There is one source of true life, and that is Jesus Christ. I'm going to have to get an amen on that one. Amen. There we go. I know it's sometimes hard. But that's a big one. Jesus Christ, who declares that I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is the only one who can make us new, the only one who can make us reborn and alive, and give us life where otherwise we are helpless, where otherwise we are just stuck in this state of sin and hopelessness, and of death. I thank God that there is more to Romans 5, 6. Romans 5, 6 begins when we were utterly helpless, and it continues. When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Christ came to change everything. And so the truth is that we are born into this state of depravity and of sin and of brokenness and of spiritual death, of spiritual helplessness. All humanity is born into this state of helplessness. The good news is that Jesus Christ came to be our help. Psalm 46, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Help to the helpless. Help to those who have no other options, no other means of new life. John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, he talked about this kind of stuff a lot, and he challenged people to understand this state of death and to challenge them to understand what Jesus offers us. He preached, know your disease, know your cure. So know your disease, know this depravity is real, but also know your cure. You were born into sin, therefore you must be born again, born of God. And so we who are born into a state of depravity, meaning all people, need Jesus to be our help. We need Jesus to make us truly alive. We need the cross. We need the resurrection. Humanity needs Jesus Christ incarnate, crucified, victorious, and reigning. Jesus is the only one who can take us from spiritual death to spiritual life. And the good news is that we are not stuck in helplessness. We're not stuck in that place. The good news is that Jesus Christ offers salvation to all people. And so, yes, this is true, that the result of sin entering the world is this overarching spiritual death and separation from God. But the good news that our loving God offers the world is that the result of Jesus Christ entering the world is life and hope. That Jesus did come into the world, become incarnate to change everything so that we aren't stuck in that place of death and separation. This is the gospel. This is the good news, that we are stuck in a place of depravity and death and hopelessness, and Jesus has come in and offering us life to change everything. And so when I think about this, when I review this gospel story, this most important news the world could ever know, I challenge myself. I'm like, do I know him? Do I really know Jesus Christ as this source of new life? And so I ask you, do you know him? Do you know him as the source of new life? The one who has brought you from death to life? Because knowing Jesus Christ is the most important thing that anybody can ever do. Screen, I'm just going to refer to it if you want to read it later on. Matthew 7, 21 through 23. Jesus essentially tells us that all the good things that we try and do don't matter unless we know Jesus. That preaching in Jesus' name, preaching incredible sermons to thousands and thousands of people and changing their lives and all this stuff, that doesn't matter unless we know Jesus. That doing miracles in his name doesn't matter unless we know him. Unless we know Jesus and allow him into our lives to know us and to change us and to make us alive. If we don't know him, we are still in that place of spiritual death. Not just about going to church and knowing facts about the Bible. It's about, do you know Jesus Christ? Have you let him in? Does he know you? Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. It says, you were dead because of your sins, and because of your sinful nature was not yet cut away. Then God made you alive with Christ. For he forgave all our sins. He canceled the record of the charges against us and took it away by nailing it to the cross. In this way, he disarmed the spiritual rulers and authorities. He shamed them publicly by his victory over them on the cross. I find this is such a cool, incredible passage, that what was meant for Jesus' shame, to hang him on a cross, bear himself in front of everyone, became the shame of the enemy. By his victory over them. This public, meant to be a public shaming of Jesus, has turned out to be the public shaming of the enemy by Jesus' victory on the cross. So we're going to take communion this morning. And I ask that we do communion, not do it a little bit differently, but approach it knowing that we're loved. Not remembering a death, but celebrating what Jesus has done. That he loves you enough to give his body and blood so that you may be made alive. So it's not about just remembering a sacrifice. That is a huge part of it. Remembering what Jesus has done for us, but also remembering that he's victorious. And he reigns and he loves you and he gave this for you. Gave his body and gave his blood so that I can be taken from this place of helplessness to a place of new life. So before we come to the table, I invite us, as we normally do, into a time of just quiet confession and repentance. And as we go to God before coming to the table, I ask, you know, how has God been sort of pulling on your heart this week? In what ways has God been challenging you and working in your heart and convicting you about really what you need to get right with him? What are some of those things that you know have just been persisting in your life? That yes, you've given your life to Jesus, you've been made new, but yet these things keep creeping in. What do you need to get right with God this morning? I ask that you go to your Heavenly Father and talk with him about it. So take a minute to do that this morning before we come to the table. Let's go to him in prayer. Lord Jesus, may this be so much more than a church tradition we do because it's the first Sunday of the month. I pray that in and through your table we meet with you. So Lord, we pour out our sins. We pour out the things we know are keeping us from you. We don't want any of that former life at all. That life of death and of sin and of helplessness. That's not what you have for us. You have given us victory. The victory of the cross and the victory of your resurrection. And now you stand over all, reigning as the King of all kings. So Lord, we invite you to reign. We invite you to take over. Help us to turn away from these things that we know has been persisting and keeping us from you. Wake us up to those things. Anything that is acting as that barrier for you using us, for us welcoming you in more fully. Help us to turn from those things. So forgive us, we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells us this. Paul writes, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. And so, brothers and sisters, hear the good news. Christ was born to save sinful people like you and me. And Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, proving his love toward us. Christ died for us and was resurrected so that we could have new life in him. And so, in the name of Jesus Christ, we are a forgiven people. All the glory belongs to God. Amen. So on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks for it, and he broke the bread. He passed it amongst his disciples and said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it, in remembrance of me. After sharing a meal with his disciples, after the supper was over, he raised the cup. He gave thanks to God for it. He also passed it amongst his disciples and saying, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So, Lord God, I ask that you just pour out your Holy Spirit on these elements and in this moment. In this sacramental act, I pray that you are at work in a new way. May we receive your grace. May we be aware of your presence. May we be aware of what you are calling us to do and to be in and through this act. So, Lord, thank you for all that you have given for us so that we may be made new. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for the empty tomb. Thank you for reigning over all. Pray all this in Christ's holy name. Amen. Maybe you are new to us this morning, and I know each church does communion a little bit differently. And so I wanted to just point out that this is an open table. Everybody here is welcome to come forward. It doesn't matter if this is your first time here. It doesn't matter if you've never been a part of a church before. If you desire a deeper walk with Christ, come forward. That is the desire of your heart, to know Jesus more fully. You are welcome to come forward. If you're not in that place yet, I respect that too. But everybody is welcome and encouraged to come forward and receive from the table of grace this morning. I'm going to invite Pastor Ken. He's going to come forward and help me serve the elements. And we do communion by intinction, which means you're going to rip off a little piece of bread and dip it in the cup and partake, and then go back to your seats. We ask that you come up the middle aisle and go through the side aisles just so we're not running all over each other. There's gluten-free station here, so this cup here and this bread is reserved for gluten-free. If this is your dietary need, please help yourself to that as you come forward. But may God be honored through our coming to the table this morning. May this be more than just a sacramental tradition, but may we experience Christ in and through the bread and the cup this morning. Pray that in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
Not just in this hour of worship, but may we show the world your goodness through through embodying you as the body of Christ, becoming the body of Christ for the world, so that they might see you in and through us. So Lord, be glorified in and through our ministry going forward, in our conversations, in our work, in our studies, in our family, in everything, Lord, may you receive the glory. We thank you for all that you have done in our lives. We praise you and we glorify you. And all God's people said together, amen. 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 Have a fantastic week. Hopefully